Hello. Is that better? I enjoyed that. Thank you very much, Evan. Is there anyone in the audience between the ages of 40 and 45? Please stand up. Don't be ashamed. Be proud. I like it. I like it. Okay, young man, pair. I'm going to ask you. Tell me a couple of things that you have learned in your years on this earth.
Some languages, I did marketing and PR, learned a lot about different cultures and coexistence by living here in Marrakesh for a while.
Thank you very much. Please, all stay standing while I ask you a question. This girl was 9 years old when her body was covered with a chemical which burned all of her skin off. It was 1972, it was the Vietnam War. 43 years later, the lifespan of these people who have learned so much, who are wonderful people in their prime, 43 years later, we have this boy, 3 years old, dead. So I would say, until we stop killing children, we still don't know how to coexist. Thank you, please. Why are we like this, the human race, when we have so many great things? Why are we like this? Well, I think it's partly genetics, it's nature. We are the silverback gorilla. We have to fight to survive. We have to compete to survive. We have to compete to eat, to have sex, to have fun. So that's in our nature. It's something about us, and it's not necessarily a bad thing. But we are schizophrenic because we are also the ant. Here you see an ant bridge across water. Many of these ants died in order for their fellow ants to walk across them so that they can bridge across this piece of water. And that is also part of our human nature. So now I'd like you all to stand up. It's a very interactive speech. So the other thing we do as humans, we have our genetics all based there, but society, of course, and our social conditioning has a very big part to play. And one of the things we love to do is we love to group around an interest. So could everybody with blonde hair sit down, please? Could everyone who speaks Russian sit down, please? Could everyone who can ride a bicycle sit down, please? Oh my goodness, could everyone who's a Muslim sit down, please? Thank you very much. So as you can see, again, groups are not a bad thing. They're a good thing. They help you feel connected with your fellow people, with your fellow humans. However, what happens when the color of your skin gives you an excuse to kill, to mutilate, to disrespect other people? What happens when what you say is your religion gives you an excuse to kill, to capture, to mutilate other human beings? That is what we have to guard against in our lives, I think, this extremism. There's also something that science teaches us from earliest times, and I don't know about you, but my parents taught me this. I once, because I was a bit of a swot, came first in every single class at school. I phoned my mum, because I was in Scotland and she was in Africa, and I said, Mum, I came first in everything. And I expected her to say, Alice, you're wonderful, you're the best daughter, you're my favourite. And she actually said, by how much? So I think from earliest times we are taught to be good, better, best, pretty, prettier, prettiest, tall, taller, tallest, and the best thing is to be the best. That is also a good thing, there is nothing wrong with it, but it can lead us into dangers. So I'd like to share a couple of my experiences with you. As Patrick very kindly said, I am an adventurer. As you can see, I'm very ordinary, but I like to challenge myself with long physical endurance events in order to kind of challenge really my soul and my spirit, to understand what it's like to be human, to understand what the universe means by being out in it. And I have learned certain things from that, which I'd like to share with you. So my first story is about a fig. Last year I did the first ever trek from the highest point of North Africa, the mountain town, to Agadir, to the ocean, the lowest point, right across the Atlas Mountains. It took 12 days. It was 300 kilometers, and it was very hard because we had to go up and down and up and down. Also, it was in August, so it was very, very hot. Sometimes we walked for 18 hours a day. My feet swelled so that I couldn't use my walking boots anymore. I was walking in my fellow walkers, trainers. He was Rashid Eid al-Mahjoub, an Amazigh, a Berber, so it was going to be a Scottish Amazigh world first to reach that ocean. And we were very competitive, we wanted to do it. There are 8 billion people in the world, and we wanted to be the first ones to do this trek. So that was what motivated us. About halfway through, we were very tired, it was very hot, it was about 1 o'clock in the afternoon, we were walking up in a lonely Abbot's village, and side to side of the road was an orchard, and overhanging, it was a stone wall about my height, but overhanging the stone wall was a fig tree with ripe black figs on it. Now, if you have ever tasted a Moroccan fig, you will know that they are the best in the world. So Rashid and I looked at each other. He got out his walking pole and he knocked figs off the tree and we started to eat them. I just gone bit my fig. I had a little bit of juice on my chin and we were feeling great. This was the best thing. When we looked up and down the winding road came a beautifully dressed Hajj on his donkey. He was dressed completely in white, had a small skull cap on, and it was obvious that he owned this orchard, and we had been caught red-handed stealing his fruit. So Rashid turned to him and said, "I am so sorry, Yash. I'm so sorry. We were hungry and it's so hot. We saw your figs. We really apologize." And the Hajj turned to us and he said, "My son, why do you think I planted a fig tree next to the road?" Of course, when we reached the ocean, we were very, very happy. We were ecstatic. It was one of the best moments of my life, and hopefully one of the best moments of Rashid's. But the thing that sticks with me is meeting that man on the road. My next story. Okay, who else has run a marathon, or a half marathon, or a 10K? Hands up, please. Bravo. Okay, so what I'm about to tell you will resonate very highly. But anyone who's done anything difficult where you feel tired, you'll feel this. So, Marrakesh Marathon. Here is my happy face. I love my fellow human beings. I am with them in this great endeavor. I feel good. So, let's start running. I'm a very slow runner. I'm running. Still feel good. About halfway through, I don't feel good. And this is when the dark thoughts enter. And usually the dark thoughts enter with yourself. So I'm like, why didn't I train more? Why didn't I do some speed training? Why didn't I eat less cake? Very quickly though, you stop thinking about what you could have done better and you start to hate other people. So immediately I go on to, there aren't enough drink stops. I haven't had water for 10 minutes. What are the organizers doing? This is a disgrace. Quickly then, you'll start to hate individuals. Ahead of me on this race, I'm quite ashamed to tell you this, there were two power walkers. And they were power walking faster than I was running, which was very, very aggravating. So I hated them, and I actually fantasized about killing them with a machine gun. But I didn't. Anyway, I continued the race, and I've got about... The understanding dawns on me that I'm last. I'm actually the last person in the marathon. So, you know, you do a marathon, you want to put it on Facebook. I'm going to have to put on Facebook that I am the last person at the marathon. There's no one behind me. Everyone behind me has been picked up by the emergency ambulance. I'm seriously running alone. Trotting. And by this time, I'm really quiet. I am actually in despair. And then, imagine the scene. Imagine some music. Out of the mist towards me on a big shining motorbike with sirens wailing comes the man that I got to know as Yusuf. He was a police motorcade rider, had a very big moustache, came right up to me and he said, "Madam, do you want to finish this race?" I said, yes, Susan, I do. So for the whole rest of the race, he drove ahead of me, clearing all traffic and all people off the Marrakesh roads, shouting, "Can't you see she's the last person?" As I approached the very end, I went past some of the big cafes in the Ibrenage, which are outside, and thanks to Yusuf, they all stood up and gave me a standing ovation as they passed. So at stake is the race, and at stake is the world title. These two men are brothers. Jonathan at the front, Alistair behind him, and Shoma behind him. If Jonathan wins the race, he not only wins the race, he wins the World Series title. Alistair is supporting him in this. They are rivals, they rival each other. If he doesn't win the race, but comes, say, second, and the guy who's currently quite far behind, Bola, comes sixth, he doesn't win the race, but he wins the title. These men sacrifice their entire lives to this sport. There is nothing else for them. So this is not like me enjoying my marathon. This is everything to them. And then look what happens. He loses it completely. 400 meters. Here's Alistair. He's coming up behind him. He can win the race. What does he do? Take his brothers. This man is going to win the race. But look at Alistair and Jonathan. He sacrifices his first place. And he knows if he can get his brother over the line second, he might still win the title. Look at them. They are world-beating athletes. He can hardly walk. His brother is carrying him. Here he comes. Look at it. Look at the face. Look. Here he comes. He pushes his brother over. Cried a lot the first time I saw it. So all I'm going to leave you with is this thought. We are competitive by nature and also taught to be so by society. We are living in a world where sometimes that has turned into extremism and it's very difficult. We have individual responsibility. So I would say that what I have learned is in the end it's never about winning or doing really well. Actually, it's about the human interaction. Our joy, our happiness comes from that human interaction. That is our true nature. And really, my last thought to you is always, always stop and carry your brother.